writing rules requiring where they would rewrite the 1964 Civil Rights Act that said, where it says you can't prohibit based on race or sex, etc. They redefined the definition of sex to include transgender, and then said schools, if you don't allow transgender students in the opposite sex bathroom, showers, and locker facilities, we're going to owe hundreds of millions of dollars in Title IX funding. Well, we said, first off, you should always accommodate kids as best you can, but that's a local decision. What you can't do, Mr. President, is you can't have the Department of Education rewrite federal law that was passed over 50 years ago and then implement it as if it was passed by Congress and then threaten to withhold money from the states. We sued and we won. We got that stopped. These are just a couple of examples of where the Attorney General really mattered. The decisions, we all joined in a lawsuit to defend religious liberty. I don't know if you watched the news, but this week the Supreme Court ruled, you ever heard of Jack Phillips, the cake baker? Where he announced, well, that we were part of that Supreme Court case in front of the court brief. We defended prayer. The town of Greece versus Galloway, in a 5-4 decision, they upheld the fact that now you guys can open prayer. You know, you almost couldn't open up prayer in public bodies. That went to the Supreme Court, and by a one vote majority, we won. We were on that lawsuit in front of the court brief. Defending life, defending the Second Amendment. And these are positions that the attorneys general have been a part of, and I have taken strong positions. Last week, I was endorsed by the NRA. I was endorsed by the South Carolina Citizens for Life because of our strong legal positions. I could talk all day about federalism, about protecting you from unelected bureaucrats in Washington or Columbia who seek to rule you through administrative fiat, but I want to move on to law enforcement real quick. When I was elected in 2010, there was no state human trafficking laws on the books. We were able to go to the General Assembly, do a lot of lobbying, the law enforcement groups were involved, the legislatures were involved. We got human trafficking laws put on the books. We now have laws we never had before. We were ranked one of the worst states in the country on the enforcement of human trafficking laws. Now, you're probably thinking, if you haven't already followed this issue, I didn't know we had the human trafficking problem in South Carolina. Human trafficking is a $150 billion a year industry affecting over 40 million victims every year, with the U.S. being the number one destination for slave trade. Number one destination. South Carolina sits between two of the top 20 human trafficking hubs in the country, Atlanta and Charlotte, your neighbor, right? And you guys are right there in the shadow. It is a big deal. Last year, we closed nearly 60 human trafficking cases statewide. We now have over 70 open cases on the books. There are people out there being traded in modern slave shops, either for sex trade or labor trade, and it is happening. But the good news is we now have a tool to address it. And the General Assembly and Governor Haley, they all gave us the tools. We've gone out there and we've made good on it. Our Internet Crimes Against Children Task Force. When I came into office, we had 44 law enforcement agencies, of which your agencies here were already on board, that were participating in protecting our children from online predators and pedophiles. We now have 108 law enforcement agencies out there on the Internet going after these thugs. We had, just this past week, we had a girl who traveled almost all the way to San Antonio, Texas because of a guy that she met online who had threatened her family she didn't get on the bus and drive them and go to Texas. She was intercepted and saved. But there are a lot of traffickers and predators using the internet to prey on our kids. Kids are also out there preying on each other. And so educating the kids on how to be good citizens of the internet is nothing our ICAT task force has done. Since I've been elected Attorney General, we have prosecuted over 750 predators online. Over 750 child predators. We have done presentations to nearly 300,000 citizens of the state, mostly young people, in the schools. We have a gang unit in our Attorney General's office in the Grand Jury Division that's going after gangs. We just busted up a marijuana trafficking ring up and down 77 between here and Columbia just last month. The prison situation, the gangs in the prisons using cell phone contraband is another issue. We indicted 34 people last summer involved in that. I could go on and on and on, but I'm going to move on to the very end. Public corruption is another area we've been heavily involved in. We've prosecuted more than a dozen law enforcement officials, many that your sheriffs, current former sheriffs, know. Three elected sheriffs were indicted while I was Attorney General. Didn't enjoy it. It had to be done. We've indicted and prosecuted half a dozen members of the General Assembly, statewide elected officials, school board officials, superintendents, county superintendents, judges, local officials, DOT officials, dozens upon dozens of people that prosecute the grand jury because of their abusing your trust. Just this week, had a major ruling come down. The federal federal government was going to shut down, unlawfully shut down, a nuclear MOX facility in Aiken. 2,000 employee people there, about 900 to 1,000 jobs in South Carolina. We filed a preliminary injunction on Friday. The judge ruled Thursday night in favor of South Carolina. Last Tuesday on Thursday night, ruled in favor of our state. So we have currently or temporarily stopped 900 people from losing their jobs as we seek to get the attorney out of South Carolina. So the Attorney General has a real effect. The last story I'm going to leave you with, and then while we're eating, I'll answer your questions. Why do I want to be Attorney General? And I'm going to close with this story. About a dozen years ago, I was a child abuse prosecutor in the Attorney General's office. And I got a case that landed on my desk, and I tell the story everywhere I go. But if you haven't heard it, it's important because it gives you a great deal of insight into how I approach this job. A young girl had been molested over a four-year period by a man who was not only the girl's grandfather, but was a retired police officer. And during that 4 years of abuse, he would say things to her like, "No one will believe you because I'm a cop and you're a kid." He abused his badge. Or, "If you tell anyone, they're going to take you away, they're going to put you in the foster care, and no one will rule the family." And he even said, "All I need is one juror to have reasonable doubt, and I'll walk." This little girl kept her mouth shut. When she was about 16, she found the courage to come forward and tell somebody. He got charged. That case came down to the Attorney General's office. It got assigned to me, and I went and prosecuted him. After a very long and graphic trial, he was found guilty. He was sentenced to 18 years in prison. And as he was being led out in shackles to go to the Department of Correction, this young girl started to cry. Now, at the time of the trial, she was 19. She was abused between 12 and 15, so 4 years since the abuse stopped. She's been living with this. We're walking out of the courtroom. She starts to cry, and I lean over to her and say, "Why are you crying? I thought this is what you wanted." And she looks up at me and she says, "Alan, you don't understand. I'm not crying because I'm sad. I'm crying because I'm happy. You see, for the first time in my life, I'm not a victim. I'm a survivor." And as I get further removed from that moment, that statement becomes more powerful to me. It inspired me because I couldn't undo what had happened to her. But I got to play a role. Now, there was law enforcement. There was victims' advocates. There was a second chair that supported the case. And it wasn't me by myself. But we got to play a role in empowering that young woman and changing how she saw herself in society, no longer as a victim, but now as a survivor. We got to give a voice to the voiceless and empower the powerless. And that's what the role of the Attorney General is. And so when I had the opportunity to run for this job, I wanted to do for all of you what I was able to play a role in doing for that young woman. Taking power from unelected bureaucrats in D.C. or Columbia, holding corrupt public officials accountable, taking the power from them and giving it back to you, going after predators, pedophiles, gangbangers, traffickers, whatever the case may be, that is the role of the Attorney General. And so that is why I'm running for Attorney General on Tuesday. You're going to have the opportunity to vote for your next Attorney General. The Office of Attorney General does not belong to me. It belongs to all of you. It's not my job, it's your job. I'm just the trustee of it. And I'm asking if you would consider making me or allowing me to continue serving as your employee, as the trustee for the Office of Attorney General for 4 more years. I'd be honored to have your vote. And one last thing, I should have started with this. I always lead every speech off with, being Attorney General is what I do. Just like being sheriff is what you do, being a representative is what you do. That's not who we are. Who I am is I'm a father. I'm a 10-year-old boy and an 8-year-old daughter. I have my wife Jennifer and I live in Lexington. I'm a colonel in the National Guard. Don't have your record, sir, but I've served 23 years, served in combat tour in Iraq, I've led soldiers in combat. So I know what it's like to lead. I know what it's like to serve. And I'd like to continue doing that for 4 more years. So I'd be honored for you to allow me to keep my job. So thank you. I appreciate you.